Coming up today, a look at global asset performances, how Wall Street got it so wrong, Tom Lee thinks we're not even halfway through, the explosion of one-day options, the latest from Jay Powell, jobs data, the latest on Trump and Biden, Tesla rips up over 10%, and I show you a 30-year back test on a diversified portfolio. Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to the Click Capital Daily Market Review. My name's Jared. I'm going to do my best to get you all up to scratch on the latest news, data, and developments coming out across financial markets, helping us all make better financial decisions. And so if you want to keep seeing more of these videos show up in your feed, then please go ahead and show some love and click that like button. You'll be really helping out the channel a lot. And let's dive right in. Pretty bullish day here. On Wall Street, S&P 500 closing above the 5,500 level for the first time ever, with a continued rotation in growth that's actually broadening out. And we can actually see the defensive sectors, healthcare, consumer staples, and utilities, all underneath their 20-day moving averages, with staples and utilities now both underneath their 50-day moving averages. Same deal with industrials and even high-yield bonds now, a little weak. We've still got growth momentum, semiconductors, financials, and consumer discretionary, along with oil, green across the board. Small caps, Russell 2000, back above the 20-day moving average, whilst we've got volatility, really downtrending, and long-dated yields picking back up above the 20-day. There's a look at all major US indices. Mega cap tech once again leading the way higher. Composite chart up almost 2% today, all-time highs. Volume breadth still coming in mid-range though. Nothing too exciting there. And overall market breadth, still more than half of all stocks below their 20-day and 50-day average. New highs versus new lows, still quite anemic, even more so on the NASDAQ. Counteracting that, volatility just on the floor, dipping below 12 today, getting down to 11.8. Actual volatility in the market, super low as well, running at an annualized rate of 7%. The two-year government bond yield, still tracking sideways here, 4.75, while the long end took a bit of a breather today as well. A little bit of a bounce back in high yield bonds. Dollar still tracking sideways. And there's Bitcoin just pulling back a touch as well. Same setup with crude along with bond yields. Just pulling back a little bit there today. Once again, it seems mega cap tech is the place to be. All rising today bar Nvidia. Still a little soft over the last week. But what really stole the show was Tesla, up over 10% today on huge volume. Video made yesterday in the daily market review, talking about the comeback of Tesla and how much it's been lagging behind the rest of large stocks over the last year. And we just heard their deliveries come in today better than expected, and we've got some other positive developments, all of which I'll dive into later on this video. So stick with me today. I've got some really interesting data I'm about to show you. And before I dive into all of that, I just want to quickly introduce myself to you guys again. I've had a lot of people join this channel over the last month or two. The total Click Capital audience across all channels now, over 10,000. So my name's Jared. That's me there in my trading office. And for a few years up until 2008, I used to work for a large investment bank in the treasury department, where I was moving around large amounts of money for high net worth investors. Also had the privilege of gaining insights and working with some hedge funds. I resigned before the GFC in 2008, and ever since then, I've been trading, investing, and working online for myself. And so each day after market close, I post a daily market review around 9 p.m. New York time, about 5 hours after close, which I review the day's events, financial news, data, and charts. And this also forms the basis of my own investment research, going into macro analysis, fundamentals, datas, leading sectors, what's really happening out there, and then combining that with the strategies and techniques I teach in my online course and my custom TradingView indicators I've developed over the last 8 years. I've combined all that into a new stock pick service, which I'll be releasing in a couple of days. And I've opened up a brand new trading account, starting from scratch with nothing. Going to deposit $500 every week with a challenge of turning it into $1 million in under 10 years. Require about an average return, a bit above 17%. And I'm doing it all out in the open with 100% transparency, making all the trades in my account after I send the picks to members, which will be sent every Sunday morning at 8 a.m. One new weekly stock pick, which I'll then be buying in my new trading account the very next day. And I've got all data plugged into a private members backend on my website for members. You can see all the open picks, records of everything that was emailed to members, screenshots of the fills straight from my trading account, and also the account balance and performance statistics plugged straight into the back end as well. Everything out in the open, transparent, and like I said, all my trades are made after I send the picks to members, including exit alerts, which I'll send the day before I make the trade as well. So if you're interested in learning more about that and want to be notified when this service is open, then click the link below this video or head directly to my website, clickcapital.io, click on the red banner at the top and enter your email in this box here to make sure you're on my email list so you can be notified and also get the 40% off discount coupon code. And I've actually got a lot of people emailing me wanting to get in earlier as I did plan on opening it on this coming Monday, the 8th of July. However, since I'll be sending the picks on Sunday morning, a lot of people have asked, can they get in before then? Because they want to know what my next pick's going to be. And so I'm still tidying up a few things in the back end to make sure everything's running smoothly. However, I'm hoping I can open the doors come this weekend, so anyone who wants to join can get notified of what my fifth pick's going to be, the stock I'll be buying this coming Monday. So if you want to be notified of that, just make sure you're on my email list by clicking the link below this video or heading straight to my website, clickcapital.io. I think you guys are going to really enjoy following this journey of mine, and I'll be doing my best to turn the account into $1 million in under 10 years. And stick with me to the end of this video, because I'm going to come back and show you the 30-year backtest results of a diversified portfolio and how you can improve returns, something I'll be doing in my new stock pick service. But first, let me share some research with you. We'll go over some data, some news headlines. I'll provide you a bit of analysis and other thoughts on the market and what else I'm seeing out there. So what you're looking at here are the performances for June, the last quarter and year to date for key global assets, using really popular traded ETFs on American exchanges. S&P 500, 15%, NASDAQ, 17%. Growth clearly leading the way. Small cap value actually down in the year, 4.8%. Obviously the yen, really bad performing currency. Sectors, no surprise, tech, communication, well out in front. Over to countries, apart from the States, India performing the best. The worst coming in Mexico, Hong Kong, and Brazil. Down the most this year out of all global markets, almost 20%. And why I think it could be setting up for good long-term value, given that it's a really commodity-focused market. Super high dividend yield, and could make for good low correlation in a long-term diversified portfolio going forward. Looking at commodities, silver leading the way this year, 22%, gold 12%, natural gas off 14%, oil up 19%, and agricultural commodities performing about the same as S&P 500 year to date. And obviously, as the bond market's been repriced, not getting in all the rate cuts it initially been hoping for, bonds are largely negative on the year, not by much though. And coming into this year, Wall Street's average S&P 500 target for year end was 4861. We just closed over 5500 today, just here at the halfway mark, above the most bullish estimates from Fundstrat, Oppenheimer, and Yardini Research. Wall Street was nowhere near as bullish on this year as we've turned out to be, kind of similar setup to last year actually as well. Not only that, the market was way more optimistic on how many rate cuts we were going to get entering 2024. Market was priced in 6-7 rate cuts. Thought we were going to end this year at 3.8%. Fast forward to today, looks like we'll be lucky if we get 1 or 2 rate cuts, taking us down to about 5% come Christmas. But once again, the stock market just acts in defiance of expectations and has just powered ahead regardless of the huge repricing in the bond market. Even got Fundstrat's Tom Lee coming out with a big bold call that the S&P 500 will hit 15,000 by 2030, driven by Generation Z and the AI wave and boom, saying this will be the third time that stocks entered a cycle where annual returns compound at high teens. And as crazy as that is, has happened probably more than what people would realize. Looking at 6-year rolling stock returns, which is about an average length of a bull market, third of the time they average higher than 14% a year. Because even though the long-term average is 8%, that's with secular bear markets as well. So we get quite a wide distribution in returns. Most years aren't around that 8%. They can be well above or a bit below. And nobody knows how long this AI boom is going to go on for. If we really see a spike in unemployment, a weak consumer could really pull it back. But for the here and now, capital expenditure from these large companies on AI infrastructure, investment, rollout, and services is just absolutely exploding. Nvidia at the forefront of benefiting from that. They're forecast to spend over $180 billion this year. And like I said, this trend is not going away anytime soon. In fact, it's accelerating. You're looking at an Amazon factory. They now employ over 750,000 robots. And so these robots cost $1 million each, meaning they can recoup their cost in under 2 years, as they do the same amount of work as 24 workers. And so AI and robots is definitely here to stay. And in fact, it's only going to accelerate. So there are real fundamentals backing up this market. Not only that, but the actual economy is also acting defiance of higher for longer in rates that we've seen this year. You can see this time last year, the forecast for 2024 growth in the US economy, GDP, is only about 0.6%. Fast forward a year, even though it's pulled back a little bit of late, still tracking at 2.3% expectations of how much the US economy will grow this year. But what really powers the stock market, especially long-term, is earnings growth. As we approach second quarter earnings season, the expectation for the S&P 500 is that year over year earnings growth should be 9%, with the median stock coming in at 5%. Infotech, communications up the top, industrials, materials down the bottom, but overall, that's really solid, healthy growth in corporate earnings. And just looking at the percent of S&P companies with positive 3-month percent changes in forward earnings, that's actually been increasing a lot this year. And typically going into those bear market recessions, it's already a bit soft sideways, and then really accelerates on the downside early in those bear markets. Another big structural reason why the stock market's been held up really well is companies are flush with cash. Profit margins are at all-time high, and the trend over the last 10, 15 years, instead of paying out dividends, companies just buy back their own stock. And like we've seen with Apple, their stock price has just gone up so much more than their revenue as they just squeeze the float. Almost works like magic. And no doubt there are signs of froth, like we can see on the latest magazine cover of Barron's. Wall Street's new hot product. Options that expire in a day. What could go wrong? Well, I've seen studies. One day options market is actually really well priced. Option dealers are pretty good at hedging out their risks, kind of just like a casino, like Citadel. They'll just take the other side of the trade, manage their book, capture the spread, and grind out a thin margin over time, even though they will take losses, and they too have their up and down periods, but they'd never write a contract that they couldn't cover. So I think fears that one day options could blow up the market are probably a bit overdone. However, this is a new realm. This is a new market, so we can't definitely say that for sure. There could still be a massive unwinding and uncoiling that leads us to a Volmageddon 2.0. I'm not ruling that out, but for the here and now, tail risks in this market just look low. Even though looking at the relative pricing of growth versus value, getting back to those bubbly levels of late 2021 and early 2000 as well, doesn't mean it can't go further, as earnings and growth stocks has been really good this last year, especially versus value and small caps. And is it even possible for the market to really fall over that hard these days, given the Fed's balance sheet, still 7.2 trillion. We're still 3 trillion above pre-pandemic levels. And back then, we're saying how crazy the Fed's balance sheet was. Just so much liquidity out there in the system, and all that money has to go somewhere. And as you know, I've been commenting how much dispersion there is in the market, implied correlation. Stocks doing their own thing, trading off their own fundamentals, even within industries. Got clear-cut winners and losers. Stock market as a whole is not really moving like a school of fish right here. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. We did see those levels back in 2017, really smooth bull market back then that persisted for another 2 years to late 2019. And just factors looking back before the last major bear market, 2007, implied correlation was materially higher, around 50-60% going into that, stayed up there for a few years. Meaning the average stock's movement is much more correlated with the overall market than what it is here and now. It's good for stock pickers. It's good for creating diversification. And just for the here and now, the first 10 trading days in July have historically been the strongest period of the year. And July overall as a month has very bullish seasonality. And in fact, a lot of new all-time highs in the first half of the year actually suggest we'll see more in the second half. Looking at S&P 500 returns after 20 or more all-time highs at the midpoint of the year, the average return for the rest of the year, 5.7%, higher 80% of the time. And overall, the full year, 100% of the time we finish higher. And so far this year in the first half, we saw 31 new all-time highs. However, in the background, we've got that pesky yield curve inversions. In fact, over 80% of all yield curves, right from the overnight Fed funds rate, 1 month, 3 month, all the way up to the 10-year, 30-year T-bonds have been inverted for a while. Looking back in history, whenever we go above that 70% threshold, the number of yield curve inversions pretty much always get the recession just around the corner. However, is this time really going to be different? Are we going to break records on this highly accurate financial indicator? Things have changed a lot since 2009. Quantitative easing, rock bottom low interest rates, the Fed put really just backstopping the system, giving us a mix now of free market capitalism, along with corporate socialism. We only really had one yield curve inversion in that time in tandem with a global pandemic to give us a brief sharp recession. But looking at a long-term S&P 500 monthly chart, you wouldn't even notice it. It was actually right here, just these two red monthly candles. A brief but sharp dip. The Fed stood in there, opened the window, flooded markets with liquidity like never before. And then stocks went on one of the most historic, sharpest rips in history. And so you wouldn't even notice it was a recession. You couldn't even really call it a bear market. 2022, technically, yes, met the definition of a bear market, off more than 20% from highs. But again, in the long-term trend, it just looks like a pullback, and one could easily make the argument that the secular bull market started in March 2009 is still going, even though it's easy to argue we'd have to be closer to the late stages of that than the start. There have been times in history where we have seen 20-year secular bull markets, and so as late as it feels 15 years into this one, there could still be a little bit more left, and it'll just be really interesting to see whether this yield curve indicator plays out and we get a recession next year. Because if we don't have a recession by 2026, one could argue that this indicator has been historically wrong for the first time. And one topic that's getting beat to death in financial media, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on, as you guys have already heard me speak plenty about it, is we do have really low market breadth. In fact, we're on pace for a record low percentage of stocks beating the S&P 500 over this calendar year, less than a quarter. And again, current market breadth, just looking at the amount of stocks beating the S&P 500, is back down to those 2000 levels. And so what does this all mean? Well, again, no indicator is right 100% of the time. There's always a different setup. History can repeat, but it often rhymes. And so I'd say one of two things is going to happen. It either means that we are in a similar setup in the late 90s, early 2000, where it's a skinny bull market marking the sign of a top. Everything's about to roll over. The market's about to crash. Or possibly we could be on the cusp of the mother of all rotations back into small caps and value stocks and dividend stocks and foreign stocks. Well, mega cap tech and large cap growth stocks take a bit of a breather. Pause, consolidate, pull back, and we don't get this big, large crash that we all naturally expect is just around the corner. Because so far this year has been a brutal run for small caps year to date. Looking at the spread of the Russell 2000 versus the S&P, huge divergence. And it's been justified because small caps have been in a much more prolonged corporate earnings recession than large caps. In fact, over the last 5 quarters, they've seen year over year declines in their earnings. Now, you've got to understand with small caps, when they bounce back, they can bounce back hard. And the expectations are for the rest of this year, going into 2025, we should see some big jump backs in earnings per share coming out of the Russell 2000 small caps. And maybe we're just closer to a bottom in the spread of the Russell versus the S&P 500 than we are to the top. And in fact, just looking at the spread of small cap value versus large cap growth, we actually look close to be putting in a double bottom, the COVID market. And this is part of the reason why my new stock pick service and then a few of my portfolios, I'm tilting towards small cap value and will stay that way. Because I think in the coming year and the following 5-10 years as well, they've got the potential to really outperform. And we see a huge reversion to the mean in both valuations and technicals. And that could help give a bit of tailwind in the portfolio and helping to hit my target annual rate as well. However, just getting back to the here and now on inflation and where interest rates are likely to go next. We heard from Jay Powell today, said inflation is showing a resuming its cooling trend. Still said he needs to see a little bit more good prints before he can go ahead and cut rates. We also heard from the Chicago Fed president, Goolsbee. Sounds like he's keen to cut rates pretty soon. Said there's warning signs of a slowdown, downward pressure on demand. And these guys have big sway on inflation, determining the price of money for us all. I'm of the opinion markets should determine interest rates. Let free market capitalism do its job. Just too hard for anyone or team, PhDs or not, to predict the future. Just look at the Fed's track record. Inflation is transitory. Stuff like this just reminds me of Milton Friedman, late great economist. One of his best quotes: inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon in the sense that it is and can be produced only by a more rapid increase in the quantity of money than an output. It's pretty simple, isn't it? But that being said, the Fed does have room to cut here. Just looking at the gap between Fed funds rate and core PCE inflation, their preferred measure, currently over 2.5%. And so they could cut 25 basis points, even 50 basis points. And that could be still restrictive enough to maybe keep a lid on inflation. However, there is a lot of variables in that. Oil and commodities being one as well, which along with shipping is still not suggesting that inflation will be under 2% anytime soon. But we live in a synchronized world, and the fact is growth coming out of the third largest economic area of the world after North America and Asia is the Eurozone. And they did see their inflation ease to 2.5% in line with expectations, with core inflation at 2.9%. And they've already gone ahead and cut. And there's a look at global growth rates of countries around the world for the first quarter this year compared to the first quarter last year. And the difference, you can see it's actually mostly red. There's Japan contracting a little bit along with Germany. US near the top at 2.9%, doing really well. Emerging markets, India, Philippines, Turkey, Russia and China, along with Indonesia and South Korea. Brazil not too far behind, along with Singapore as well. And again, with all the data, feel free to pause your video player to take a deeper look at it. Here's global central bank policy rates. So we've got the central bank rate, what you could kind of think of as the overnight cash rate. It's kind of the big one in financial markets. A lot of banks will try and charge out their mortgages 2-3% higher than this. In the second column, consumer price index, CPI, year over year change. Then the real central bank rate, which is basically the overnight rate minus inflation, gives you the inflation adjusted central bank rate. Then the year over year CPI trend versus the prior reading and the central bank's last move. And you can see looking around the world, it's a mix of cuts and hikes, but we are seeing a growing amount of cuts. However, looking at Australia recently, inflation did come in hot. Markets actually pricing in another potential hike, although they haven't moved since November last year. And there's Japan with the third worst real central bank rate, minus 2.8%. That's because their overnight rate's only 5 basis points. Inflation's still running at 2.8%. Big reason why their currency's getting pummeled. They just can't raise their interest rates because they can't afford to pay that back on debt. Kind of between a rock and a hard place. There's the US, much more healthy with a real rate of 2.1%. And inflation's not some boogeyman that can't go away. Just look at what's happening in Argentina. Javier Milei, a man who really understands economics and finance well. He's really put the government back in order, slashing costs, even flies economy class himself, and it's amazing to see how fast it's working. They've been suffering from high inflation for years, currency been decimated, many people struggling just to buy fruit and vegetables. As their government became so bloated and large and corrupt, socialist policies, he's just come in there, slash things left, right, center, trying to privatize everything as much as he can, let the private sector run it, as he knows it's much more efficient instead of a government. So he's downsizing the government, creating a much smaller government, less tax, and letting entrepreneurs largely drive the economy like it should be. Even in his bio on X, he lists himself as an economist, not even the president of Argentina. He's there to do business. He's there with clear-cut goals to get inflation down and help turn around his country that he loves. Good news is it's working, and it's working quickly. Argentina inflation fell in May for the fifth straight month, getting down off those crazy record highs and even below the optimistic forecasts, cooling for the fifth straight month to 4.2%, down from crazy numbers of 25% last year. And it's just amazing to see, especially considering Javier Milei has only been on the job for 6 months. Look at the results he's already achieving, just showing that it is possible for governments to have big and fast effects on inflation. That is, if they really want to. And the US jobs market continues to hold up. Job openings rose slightly in May. There's a look at the long-term trend over the last 10 years of monthly job openings. Did see Treasury yields pull back in the long end after they had a huge rip these last couple of days. A lot of people wondering why that is. Is it because the Japanese dumping US treasuries to help prop up their currency? Well, I'm sure there's been some of that. However, the Japanese don't make up the entire market of the largest financial asset in the world, long-dated US treasury bonds. Like I've been saying the last few days, I think it's the market pricing in a Trump win. Big move since we got that Trump-Biden debate. Betting markets have spiked that he's going to win. Biden's fallen off a cliff, and it could be a case of both pricing in higher and stronger growth, along with uncertainty on debt. And this is a similar move we saw back in 2015. When it started becoming more obvious Trump was going to win, markets around the world started pricing in a lot stronger economic growth, for which they were actually correct. And there's still widespread speculation Biden's just about to be replaced. However, we're hearing some reports that Biden's inner circle is urging him to stay on, especially his wife Jill Biden, who apparently does not want to give up power just yet. But it's looking more and more likely that Kamala Harris is going to be pushed into the top job and going toe-to-toe to Trump this coming November. Because we've actually just seen a big repricing in betting markets, even the last day. Trump's still really high, 59%. Biden's really fallen off, 16%, with Kamala Harris overtaking Gavin Newsom, now close to 12%, approaching even odds with Biden. Looks like someone may know something. Maybe some of that inner circle communications has been spilled out, and we could be on the cusp of an announcement from the Democratic Party soon. However, it looks like there's a bit of a power struggle going on within. Like I said, apparently Jill Biden wants her 81-year-old husband to stay in office another 4.5 years. And there's a look at the 10-year, just hovering around 4.43. Still much higher than when the Trump and Biden debate was held. Markets definitely moved off that. Moving on to Tesla, and a follow-up for my video yesterday. We got their deliveries coming today, better than expected. They delivered 444,000 units, exceeding estimates of 438,000. Wedbush analyst Dan Ives saying the worst is over for Tesla. It's a huge comeback, and we're all looking forward to the robo-taxi day on August 8. And this was a pretty good result in the face of softness in the market for sales of new cars, barely rising in the second quarter, pretty much flat, only up 0.1%. And hidden within those results was something else doing really well that I also covered yesterday in the daily market review. Is yes, they beat a little bit on deliveries of EVs by 6,000 cars, not a huge beat, but we also got to hear about their energy storage business, which is growing leaps and bounds. In fact, Tesla deployed 9.4 gigawatt hours of battery storage in the quarter, which is a record by more than 100%. Prior high was 4.1 gigawatt hours. And like Dan Ives said, that number was huge. Monster storage number that will move the needle. Could mean an incremental $2 billion in sales and $400 million in gross profits. And like I said, this is another area of the Tesla business a lot of investors underestimate: energy storage. Because wind and solar are currently the two biggest leaders in clean energy. However, the thing is, the wind's not always blowing, the sun's not always out. That energy has to be stored. And Tesla batteries and megapacks are currently the best in the world at doing that. And this too is a trend that is only going to grow and accelerate, along with the potential of Robotaxi and their Optimus robot as well. And that's why you should never short Tesla. Can't imagine how many billions of dollars have been lost of people trying to short this stock over the years. It's the same story I've been hearing since day one. Because when Tesla rips, it can just rip so hard, even for a $700 billion market cap company. We saw that again today. Up 10% on over 200 million shares traded. Just like Nvidia, it too is an absolute monster. And if Robotaxi goes well and their earnings in 15 days, we could be on our way back to $300 a share before Christmas. And there's actually an interesting pattern in the stock price of Tesla in the 2 weeks before and the 2 weeks after its earnings announcements. It'll quite often dip down going into it and then rip afterwards. Looking at the three-year average, it's about 10% return, taking the following 2 weeks minus the 2 weeks prior. So we may see a dip in the next 2 weeks before earnings. And if history repeats, that could set up for a good buy the dip opportunity. And just a reminder, the US stock market will be closed this Thursday, the 4th of July, as Americans observe their Independence Day, breaking away from British rule, becoming an independent republic, and truly the outlier of global history. One of the youngest countries out there, overtaking thousands of years old economies to become the largest economy in the world in just over 200 years. The market will also shut early tomorrow at 1 p.m., half-day trading, and then we'll be back open on Friday, the 5th of July, as per usual, where we'll be greeted with some jobs data. The most important this month, non-farm payrolls, unemployment rate expected to come in 4%, U.S. economy expected to have generated 200,000 new jobs in the month of June. There's a look at your economic calendar today. Eurozone inflation coming in as expected. JOLTS job openings better than expected. Same with the RCM Economic Optimism Index. Crude oil stocks coming off a lot. Tomorrow we get ADP employment data, along with exports and imports, jobless claims, services PMIs. We're closed Thursday and then Friday. Jobs data, most important print we'll get this week. Currently, market not forecasting anything too special to happen there. And the market's slightly increasing the chances we'll see a rate cut in September. Almost 70% now after we heard from Jay Powell today. A little more on the dovish side, but still pretty much repeating his prior language that he needs to see some more good data before he can go ahead and pull the trigger. Feed and Greed Index smack bang in the middle at 50, and corporate insider trading really dying off, and I'll probably stop reporting on this for a couple of weeks as we go into that corporate buyback period and the thick of summer. It's not a whole lot of relevance in this data right here and right now. And like I said at the start of this video, I was going to show you something I thought you might find interesting, a 30-year backtest of a diversified portfolio. And so just looking at four major asset classes: stocks, as measured by the S&P 500, the total US bond market, real estate investment trusts, and gold. You can see the rolling correlations. All of them are pretty good, the biggest being between stocks and REITs. However, the overall inter-portfolio correlation score, IPC, still under 0.5. And doing a backtest on this portfolio, an equal amount in stocks, bonds, REITs, and gold. Looking at the results over the last 30 years, starting with $10,000, just left alone, it went up almost tenfold to $99,000. Compounded annual growth rate, 7.8%, which there's nothing wrong with compounding your money at that rate, especially when the maximum drawdown was only 28%. Even the S&P 500 has had a 55% drawdown in that time. A lot of people just find that too hard to hold through, not to mention the volatility it can create in your wealth, especially if you're approaching retirement or in retirement. You don't want to see your nest egg go down by more than half. There's the equity curve from 1994 of that diversified four asset portfolio. And I'll show you what happens when you dollar cost average into this portfolio. So for example, if we contribute a fixed amount, even just $1,000 a month, that's $250 a week. And if we adjust that for inflation, so we increase that by about 2, 3, 4% a year, our monthly contributions of $1,000 a month. Again, starting with $10,000 30 years ago, just looking at the results of dollar cost averaging, that $99,000 turns into $1.9 million, taking your average annual compounded growth rate to 18.8%, actually decreasing your drawdown to 25% thanks to the beauty of dollar cost averaging. And there's your equity curve over that time. And that's just adding $1,000 a month, $250 a week, increasing that by inflation each year, so 2-3% a year. And it just goes to show that consistent saving and disciplined investing, even into a simple diversified portfolio. You don't have to find the next Bitcoin, you don't have to find the next Nvidia. Just sticking to a simple strategy, along with dollar cost averaging, can create sizable wealth over the long term. And that's something I'll be doing in my stock pick service, contributing every week and buying a new stock, as the service is going to be just as much a demonstration of consistent saving and disciplined wealth building as it will be about successful investing and portfolio management. And that's a bit of a personal finance hack. So you want to save first and spend later. So for example, with this new service of mine, I'm contributing $500 a week to the account to buy a new stock. And I've set that up as an automatic direct debit from my account. So I'm treating it like a bill. And so if you imagine someone else is billing you this, that you have to pay this bill. Another way you could think of it as your future self billing you today. And so the idea is you pay your bills first, and then whatever's left, you can spend on discretionary items, going out to eat, buying new goods and things or whatever you're into. Whereas the opposite, spending on a credit card is kind of like sending yourself a bill in the future. Quite literally, actually. We're all selfish by design. And so having a credit card with a large limit allows you to kind of punish yourself in the future for the pleasure of today. And don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with having a credit card. We all need one. However, it's just best to keep that limit as low as possible. And like I said, set up direct debit savings for contributions into your investment accounts and treat them like bills that you have to pay. Bills from yourself in the future. Save first and then spend last. And so just being a disciplined saver and spender, that's all part of creating wealth and something I want to demonstrate in my new stock pick service, as well as sharing the stocks I'm going to buy and being 100% transparent with the results, along with sharing with you the reasons why I'm buying a stock and how I construct and manage a portfolio as well. Putting it all out there in the open, nothing to hide, no fluff or filler, and not just overwhelming you with information and a part-time job like a lot of these other trading memberships do. I'm all about delivering results in the most simple, clean way possible. So like I said, if you're interested in learning more about that and want to be notified when I open this service, which could be just in a few days from now, once I finish tidying up the back end, making sure everything's running smoothly, then head on over to my website, clickcapital.io, click on the big red banner at the top and enter your email address in this box here. So you're on my email list and I'll let you know as soon as it's open, along with that 40% discount coupon code. And I'm really excited to launch this. I think you guys are going to learn a lot and really enjoy joining me on this investment journey, as I'm not going to stop until I turn my new account into $1 million. Other than that, that's all I have for you today. Thanks very much for tuning in, and I'll be back this time again tomorrow night to review the market again. See you then, guys. Cheers.